Discover your inner goddess and live up to your highest value and most abundant potential. Welcome to Grateful Goddesses, a podcast that empowers you to unleash your inner goddess and take the leap of faith to live your best life. Your guide, Karen Pulver, joins her fellow goddesses in soulful conversations about gratitude, personal growth, authentic living, and a bevy of topics affecting women today. Let's start the show with your host, Karen Pulver.
Thank you, everyone, for joining us today on Grateful Goddesses. I am incredibly grateful to be in my 50s. I never thought I would say that all those years ago. You know, when you're younger, you just can't wait to grow up, right? And then as you get older, you just can't wait to get to be younger and do everything you can to be younger. But in my 50s, I've just learned so much over the years. And I actually reach out to people that are older than me for advice. In fact, we had a guest goddess, Elaine Soloway, who's in her 80s, that gave us some wonderful life lessons. Now, today, we're going to take a whole different twist and go on the other spectrum and learn from a fabulous, beautiful woman in her 20s. In fact, she's 26. She's a so-called millennial. Some people like that term, some people don't. We'll ask her about that. And she's going to teach us some really important life lessons and new perspectives on how we are going to think about the world. And it's just, as a grateful goddess, as a woman, it's important to have these very challenging yet important crucial conversations. So we're going to be meeting with Ella Saint-Hilaire. She is a poet, sculptor, and activist. Her work this year has largely been focused on magnifying the intersection of radical spiritual consciousness and social injustice initiatives. A polyglot and lifetime nomad. Can't wait to ask her about that. She draws inspiration and creative energy from collaborating with her international community. She currently lives in Brooklyn, New York. Thank you, Ella, for joining us on the show today.
Thank you for having me.
Oh, it's so nice to have you. And thank you for saying yes to being here today and for saying yes to agreeing to have some amazing yet might be difficult conversations. I want to know first, though, about being a polyglot nomad. Tell me about that.
So my mother is Haitian and my father's Polish. I was born in Chicago, but I moved away when I was 3 and we just kept moving. So I had a lot of different experiences growing up in France and Poland and Canada and in Haiti until I came back to the States for college. So the majority of my life I was abroad and then I came back. So I kind of have an American and international view on the world.
Okay. And then tell me too about what your interests are. You have so many.
Yeah. So I'm primarily an artist and a writer. Those are kind of my two functionalities. But I really believe in being multidisciplinary and just bring creativity to everything you're doing. So like last month, I launched my own business and my own platform on Instagram called Bedrock Body. But that has always like a creative twist to it. And I bring with me and with my experience, all of my poetry, my sculpture. But in anything you do, I think it's good to bring your talents forward and to just apply that, you know.
Have you been told by, you know, someone my age that no, you need to just focus on one thing?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I've heard that a lot, but even from people my age, you know, they're like, wouldn't you be more successful if you focused on one thing?
Right.
But I find that I'm actually more fulfilled when I'm juggling a lot of different balls, activating different parts of my brain. I feel more wholesome, more just well-rounded. To me, that's what well-rounded is. It's like basically acknowledging all the different parts of yourself and saying, okay, I love poetry. I want to do that. And I also want to paint. And those two things complement each other for me.
So your passions are so aligned with, you're just like taking everything and being creative. Is there, when you talk about your new business, Bedrock Body, can you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah. So it was really catalyzed very honestly by when George Floyd was murdered. And I was asking myself very deeply, I was very angry. And I was asking myself, okay, how can I contribute? I'm surrounded by such a beautiful spiritual community. And a lot of people were coming to me for advice, for business advice of how to move forward with their initiatives, personal advice about how to talk about these issues, and just general questions, right? Mm-hmm. And they felt safe with me. And I felt grateful that people came to me with that trust. But I basically decided within a couple of days, within my meditations, I was having such powerful inspiration and channelings. And I was saying, you know what, let me put together all of my resources, all of my knowledge, and just package it in a way on a platform where people can, you know, access it very easily. So the platform is just all about mind, body, and spirit alignment. Pretty simple. But I'm presenting it as my own version of that, right? So it's at the intersection of spirituality and a spiritual practice, which I believe is very, very important for awakening yourself and for being conscious about what's going on, not only with you, but within the world. Mm-hmm. And that bringing that forward with, you know, action steps, like viable discussions that are going to catalyze and move people forward and bring about real change. So it's really just the embodiment of that.
Well, you took your anger and you turned it into action. And it seems like you turned it into, I'm trying to remember exactly what Dr. Edith Eger, a Holocaust survivor, told us. She mm-hmm. said, you know, instead of being angry, it's important to turn that into doing work, into helping others, mm-hmm. and not focusing so much on that anger. And it's amazing how, I don't mean to be judging, but you're young, and to come to this realization at a young age. I mean, I just feel like I'm awakening in my 50s in so many areas of my life. So I can't wait to dive in deep about other questions we have for you. So I'd like to welcome our featured goddesses, Alyssa, Dina, and Rachel. Alyssa, would you like to start?
Sure. Nice to meet you, Ella. Gosh, you have done a lot at your ripe old age of 26, and it seems like it's amazing. We have talked to a lot of goddess guests, and they've generally all been older, so you can wear this sort of like badge of honor of being so far our youngest featured guest. You know, I don't know if you like or don't like the term millennial. We'll just say your generation, right? We'll put it out there for people who don't like the term. But like, how do you think your view of the world differs from, you know, our generation, your parents' generation, maybe your grandparents' generation? So much going on in the world today, like where to even begin. But how do you think your worldview differs? And really for you, it's kind of a truly international global worldview.
Yes. I think what makes millennials... what makes us very unique is that we have a lot of resources. We grew up with technology for, you know, in large part. And technology in and of itself, I believe, is a privilege. Just to be able to have a smartphone, for those of us who are lucky to have that, gives you access to so much information, right? And so I feel like millennials, for the most part, are very informed, very active, and very vocal. And I feel like we don't settle for a lot, you know, like we like to ask questions, we like to have debates, we like to challenge the status quo. And I think, you know, with my parents' generation, for example, that's been a point of contention sometimes when I've chosen to do one thing very corporate, for example, and then the next year I want to change directions. They don't really understand that, right? And I'm like, but these are the different parts of me, and I don't want to settle for something if it doesn't really satisfy all of me. And I feel like it's mostly a debate between like freedom versus security. I feel like my parents' generation is very grounded. They're very secure. They tend to do one thing for their entire lives, which I very much admire, dedicating yourself to a certain practice or career or vocation. But I think my generation is a lot more about freedom, flexibility, moving around, and just really following your passion and really like putting your all into it. So I do like that about millennials.
Yeah, I wish our generation was more like that. But you're right. We are more about sort of security than freedom, I think.
But here on Grateful Goddesses, we're learning to expand our, you know, stepping out of our box and opening up to more experiences. And some of us even have thought about the career that we have or that we've had, that perhaps we can open up to other areas of things that we're passionate about. We've talked to guests too that have had jobs of, you know, six-figure jobs, and then they just left on a dime just to like start something that they've been really passionate about. and taking right. that leap is really scary. So Rachel, how about you?
Would yeah,
you-
I'd like to, I love that you want to, like using your passion to move forward and all the faculties and access you have to make good in the world. And I'd love to know more about your new company and like how people engage with you and how you can educate people and make them feel better. But also, do you feel unique in this venture? I know you were talking about kind of millennials in general, but you know, there's, you know, the politics of the world, and because I don't want to say that it's our generation that doesn't care about the environment. There's like, you know, there are people who don't care as much about, and there are people that do. But your generation, like in general, and we all have kids close to your age, and it makes me sick, the state of the world and the priorities. And I'm just curious, do you feel that everyone is like you and everyone is trying to make change for the better? And
well, so I would have to say with my company, actually, my inspiration was my Kundalini yoga teacher. Her name is Desiree, and she's become a really close friend of mine. She runs something called Benchen Course, which is an online Kundalini and like life coaching course. But she is someone who has brought about all of her different interests, her acupuncture training, her life coach training, and her yoga teacher training to make one singular thing. And so when I was thinking of how can I contribute and thinking of Bedrock Body, I was like, oh, I can really come forth as myself with all of my different interests and present something that's uniquely me, but that is complex in the way that all human beings are complex, right? So I feel like I'm doing it uniquely in my way, but I don't think that it's something that is just exclusive to, you know, my sort of talent or whatever. I think that I do have a way of curating things and of activating people's minds and of being very open-minded and wanting to have difficult discussions. I would say that's uniquely me, but you know, I do see a lot of people trying to combine their interests and trying to, whatever their talents are, be of service in some way, shape, or form. And that's why I have a lot of different contributors with different talents come on. You know, we're not doing the same thing every week. Sometimes, like, 1 week we had someone come on and teach vegan brownies, for example, because I do believe in being happy and being nourished and just fulfilling yourself in that way and being light. And then the next week, you know, we'll have a discussion on like the revolution and social justice and how to move forward. So it's really about being wholesome and about being a fully fulfilled human being. And I believe that applies to everyone.
Absolutely. Dina?
Rachel kind of touched me on what I was sort of thinking, but just when you just were speaking, it sounds like you have a really great perspective on balance. And I'm wondering if you can elaborate a little bit more, like just on your day-to-day with the world the way it is right now, how do you keep yourself balanced and happy and not feeling isolated? And
yeah, I think, I mean, I'm working on that still. I think that that's always a work in progress, but the way that I kind of think of it in my mind is trying to balance the masculine with the feminine. And again, this relates to my spiritual practice. I think the masculine, so-called more patriarchal force will be, you know, very organized, very like to-do lists, very just like single-minded productivity, which I think we're all very, very familiar with in our modern age, versus a more feminine force, like where I want to rest some days, I want to sleep in, I need to listen to my body, I need to maybe just eat a burrito versus eating super healthy. You know, I think it's really about intuition and tapping in and listening to yourself. But mostly, it's also about connecting to community and having that support. I mean, I wouldn't be able to do all the work that I do and be inspired and have this much energy if it weren't for especially the women around me. I mean, I have amazing guy friends, but my girlfriends are like my rock, you know? And I find it really beautiful when women come together and support one another in that way. And it's like, if you ever do have a down moment or you're doubting yourself or you're wondering if you should even continue, having that support system is really, really important to moving forward.
We talk about that all the time, especially this podcast, listeners and viewers. We talk about not putting each other down. A lot of times we, women and men, but especially I feel women, we put each other down. And I see it in young girls too. I'm a teacher and I see young girls putting each other down and not lifting up and supporting each other. And that mm-hmm. support system is crucial. Absolutely. I would like to talk with you. You and I were speaking on the phone and you came out and said, I want to have those tough conversations. how do we start?
I mean, I would pose as a question to all of you, and maybe you can respond as you see fit, is just like, where do you see within your own lives, with your own talents, where can you be of service? What's your unique quality that only you can do within your community, within your family? How do you believe your contribution matters during these times? I mean, it's difficult, I think, for a lot of people to know where to start. But maybe we can just have this, a little bit of this conversation. I mean, even this podcast, even doing this episode, it's like, okay, like this is going on in the world. We want to have this conversation. We don't know how to maybe formulate it in the best way. And I think people feel scared to ask questions, but I'm definitely here to build bridges. And it's definitely my mission to just be open and non-judgmental. So whatever you feel like asking me,
and we hope the listeners too are open and non-judgmental. Obviously, if you're watching, we are white. The four of us are white women. For me personally, doing this podcast, creating awareness, absolutely, and having this discussion and having this episode, I have learned so much just what's coming out on the forefront of racism, systemic racism for me, realizing that when I was younger, that a lot of different ways that I lived was actually racist. And I, now as an adult, I never, ever had to have the conversation with my teenage children or my teenage son if he was stopped by a police officer what to do. Never. So hearing other women my age, other Black women say that they had those conversations with their children, I have to understand that that is something that's so prevalent, that's always been, but I yet was ignorant to it. So I am listening. I want to learn. I want to educate. And I think that's a first step.
Absolutely. I think it's important to also have those revelations, but also not to feel guilt about it, right? Because I think a lot of people, like, you know, they like to use the term white privilege and use it as kind of a derogatory term and point fingers at people. But the fact is, I mean, you're blessed and lucky that you never had to have that conversation with your children, right? And that's not something that anyone should have to do. I think the point is simply realizing that people are having different life experiences. People are in different life situations where they are being faced with this on a day-to-day basis. And it's something that they live with and that they're embodied with. And so the question is simply, okay, like, what can I do with this position of privilege, right? How can I use my voice? How can I learn from others right. and be open? And also within our families, I think most of the work and most of the way of how we're going to change the world is having these conversations with our families, right? The responsibility of having children and having them grow up with, you know, a new, that's the future, right? That's the new future is the generation that is growing up. So that's a lot of work already within and of itself, you know?
That we all live in Chicago. And by that, I mean like downtown Chicago, not like we live in a suburb and we say live, we actually live downtown in Chicago. And we send our kids to various schools, high schools, whatever. And you know, you talk about community. Well, our community, we've got our family and then our kids' school and our friends and, you know, and your community expands from there. But I think for me, I always felt my kids were blessed to be able to live in an urban center, in a diverse world around them, that their view of the world was far more, you know, expansive than growing up in, you know, a rural area or a suburb that was very homogenous. But, you know, we're all learning day by day as social media has sort of brought to light that, you know, even the schools that they went to, the high schools in particular, when you're sort of really coming of age, you know, there are people now, students, you know, alumni, parents, these communities of people who are saying,
you didn't have any idea what was going on. Let me tell you what my experience was. Let me tell you what happened, whether it was like yesterday or 20 years ago when I was a student there. So my point of all this is that I think we think that, you know, in addition to the own work that we do within our families, our own conversations that we have, that by virtue of the fact that they live where they do, that this, not that we believe it didn't happen, these things don't happen, but we just didn't really, I didn't realize the extent to which at the schools that my kids were at, that all of this was going on.
Right. I think it's very interesting because environment definitely plays into a lot of your experience. Being exposed to different environments can teach you a lot, and having diverse environments is very, very important. But it's interesting. I mean, I don't think you can take for granted the fact that even within that environment or that bubble, that different people are having various different, you know, triggers or things that are happening to them within the school hallways or what have you. Even with me, within college, I had a lot of experiences where, you know, the Black Lives Matter movement started when I was in college at Duke University. And I would see the way that my Black friends would react to this and how they were being active versus some of my white friends were acting. And it was like, we were all in the same bubble, right? And it's a pretty privileged, elite, educated, highly educated bubble. And yet people's paradigms in their minds were very different, and how people felt responsible for certain things was very different. So I think it's important to acknowledge that no two people have the same experience. No two Black people, no two brown people, no two Asians, no two white people, anyone. Like, everyone has their personal viewpoint, and you can have the same conversation with another Black person and they will give you a different opinion, right? So I think it's just important for us to stay open-minded and to mostly listen. I mean, my teacher has taught me a lot about conscious communication, and the first step of nonviolent conscious communication is listening to people, and to understand that receiving that experience and understanding, okay, she's different from me, he's different from me, they're different from me, is part of how we build bridges within our communities.
I just want to add in here the whole notion of listening, and this has been a very interesting time. You know, the Black Lives Matter movement, although I obviously knew about it before, it hasn't been until now that I'm actually actively in conversations. I'm actively reading the book White Fragility. I've known about it, but I'm reading it now and engaging in these conversations. And so there is a beautiful thing happening where the news cycle isn't turning over anymore. And I do feel like it is a period of listening for all of us.
Absolutely.
So I just wanted to comment. I love how you talked about listening, because I really do believe that's the key right now, is we all need to listen and look and get outside of ourselves.
Absolutely. And I think that comes in a lot, you know, within the wellness industry as well. There's been a lot of questioning, you know, the spiritual wellness industry, and redefining what wellness really means. I think in the past years, there's been a lot of emphasis on self-care, right? And that's kind of that inward direction that you're describing, and taking care of the self and nourishing the self and finding prosperity for yourself. And, you know, maybe your nuclear family is like a small extension of that. But now I hear a lot of people having a different kind of conversation. And that is, you know, wellness does not exist without community. And we cannot have wellness as like a singular individualistic thing. I mean, individualism is not the way of the future, I believe. It never has really worked, but I think there's a new reckoning happening now about how to come together and really have wellness, you know, be for all people. I mean, for example, in New York, we have these free community fridges where people donate food. They put the food in the fridges on the street, and then the people that need it take it out. And that's a very small thing that I've seen, but that has a very large impact. I mean, I was sitting at one of my favorite coffee shops and seeing someone who really, really needs food look into that fridge and find what they need, those resources. That's shifting the community in real time. You know, it's happening very deeply. And then, you know, to have someone else bike by and to bring more food. I mean, people are very aware of how wellness and eating well and taking care of yourself extends to other people. It has to. So those are the little things that I love to see happening.
That's an incredible initiative, whoever has started that.
I don't know who started it, but it's a trend. And it's, I think it's especially in Brooklyn. I've seen them at a lot of different places. People will take old fridges and paint them. And then they plug them into their stores, you know, in front of their coffee shops or whatever. And it's amazing.
That is amazing. Whoever is listening, if you are doing that, please reach out to me because I would love to have a conversation with you. I would like to dive a little deeper. You asked us what we're doing. We're reading, we're listening, we're educating. I know my daughter, who's in her 20s, is posting a lot on social media about injustices that's going on. I'm trying to use this platform to spread awareness. And, you know, there's often that question, what else can we do? And while I'm not asking you to answer, you know, that broad question, perhaps we can just have that discussion. I like it. I like the idea of not just going inward in self-care, but looking outward to the community. Mm-hmm. So maybe what are other ways that we can express that and work on that?
I think it's very important for people to figure that out for themselves, honestly, because I think that no real change happens from someone telling you what to do. I know that there are a lot of offerings out there. I mean, for example, I'm designing an entire course that is going to start in September. It's going to be a month-to-month course, and it's going to be really about having these discussions with professors and people in various fields who are having these questions. You know, everyone has to find the space within themselves. I think that's why I emphasize so much, like, my goal is really to build leaders in their own fields, right? Mm-hmm. And with their own talents. Because, for example, my friend who's a chef, you know, she didn't know what to do at the beginning of all this. She was like, I'm at a loss. I don't know where to start. And I was like, why don't you come on my platform and teach us how to make bone broth? Because I honestly have not eaten properly for the past 2 weeks. I'm stressed out. I'm tired. I can't function if I'm not nourishing myself. And so your talent of being able to make, you know, the best bone broth in Savannah, which is what she's known for. She was in the local newspaper. That's a unique talent, and it's useful to a lot of people. We need to sustain ourselves and our bodies in order to go out there in the world and to be powerful as we can be. So I think that's really, it's really an individual question, but my goal is always to inspire people by what I'm doing or by sharing other people that I know who are working in various fields. And to just, I think that exposure helps people to find out like, oh, wait, I can do this thing. Like, oh, I have a unique talent that I haven't used in a while, or that I would like to explore a new field and just start somewhere, you know.
Exactly.
It doesn't have to be big, but it has to feel right to you.
Yes. Well, as we talked about, Rachel, you said you were reading White Fragility, which I actually listened to her podcast and read that book as well, which Ella, have you?
I've not read it. To be honest, for myself, I really prefer to read Black writers, Black and Brown writers. Even like queer writers, because I like to really listen to the voices that are the most radical. I mean, for me, I'm looking at my table right now, I'm reading the autobiography of Malcolm X. And to dive into these leaders who were very, very revolutionary, but I feel they've been stereotyped in our popular culture, in our history books. Mm-hmm. They're very, very complex individuals. And that's why, you know, a lot of my course will be about looking into the complexity of these individuals and these voices that we think we know, right? We think we know Rosa Parks, we think we know MLK, but we really don't.
That's right.
And it's by looking at these leaders that we can really inspire ourselves to be complex, to be imperfect, and to still show up at the table. I mean, MLK was 26 when he started first doing his speeches. So these are very young radicals who had very different points of view than just, you know, the clickbait and the quotes that we all see going around that are sometimes taken out of context. But it's very important for me to centralize those Black and Brown voices because they've been unheard in the past. And so I've heard a lot of people reading the White Fragility book, but just for me, mm-hmm. I'm like, I would rather read some bell hooks, you know what I mean?
Well, yeah. Another book though that I highly recommend is I'm Still Here by Austin Channing Brown. Mm-hmm. And she is a Black writer. And mm-hmm. what struck me in her biography and her book, but she wrote about her hair. Mm-hmm. She talked about her hair and mm-hmm. how when she was younger, everybody wanted to touch her hair. Also, she talked about the Black community because being in certain groups that she was in and trying to define herself in that community as well, mm-hmm. in her own community as well as the white community. So that's an excellent book to read.
I haven't read it, mm-hmm. but I will say that hair is definitely a big thing. It's a big discussion, and it's an identity thing, and it's uh-huh. belonging to a kind of lineage, and it's an art as well. I mean, I put my hair in braids recently, and it made me feel different. You know, it definitely affects. I mean, we've all, you know, had the experience of a haircut or something and see how we feel differently in the world. But it's very profound for Black women to talk about hair because, you know, for example, I used to straighten my hair my whole life because I wanted to match this ideal, this white ideal of beauty, which was straight, flat hair, you know. Mm-hmm. I thought that was beautiful because those were the images being imprinted in my mind. And so these kind of like, you know, and they're white supremacists, really kind of ideals ingrained within yourself. And it's very interesting to look at them and to see how you're not exempt from, you know, that self-hatred sometimes of like wanting that white ideal. I mean, these are very difficult conversations to have, but I definitely feel different when I embrace my hair texture versus when I try and fight it, you know? And that's kind of a self-acceptance thing. It's very deeply personal. I've definitely cried about my hair a lot, you know?
Really?
A lot. Oh, absolutely. It's been a journey, but we could do a whole podcast on that.
Just about accepting your hair.
Just about hair. Yeah, just about how you choose to wear. I mean, it's a very political thing, right? The personal is political.
Yes.
I think we all, for example, associate the imagery of the Afros, you know, with the Black Panthers, for example. And the reason why they were doing that was kind of, you know, Black power, Black is beautiful. That message that they had was very avant-garde at the time and it intersected, you know, with the hippie movement and kind of being more natural. And now, you know, there's a lot of, for example, pressure on Black women to wear their hair naturally because that's more quote unquote authentic. Mm-hmm. But if you don't want that as an individual, right, does that mean that you're suppressing yourself if you would rather have straight hair? I mean, it's a whole complex conversation, but just, you can see within this one subject how complex it can be and how personal it is as well.
Right. And how political, like you said.
Yeah.
Ella, what is your take then on removing books, you know, or media or content?
Good question.
We've seen that a lot in the news and people talking about it from both sides of the conversation. So I'm just curious what your thoughts are.
I think my personal take, and again, this is just me, someone may have another opinion, but I don't believe in removing or banning any books. I'm thinking back, for example, to the time in college when I was taking a history class on Weimar Germany. And, you know, we read Mein Kampf, like big sections of Mein Kampf. And, you know, I know that book, for example, is banned in Germany. You're not allowed to sell it. But I think that openness of being able to read any resource and to read it with a critical mind, right? I think that education is mostly about not this is what you should think, but this is how you should approach thinking for yourself, right? So the ability, and that's real intelligence to me, is being able to pick up any resource, any book, and to say, okay, I don't believe in this, or I do believe in this. And I think I credit a lot of that to my diverse education and being exposed to different authors. You know, there's a whole thing now of cancel culture, right? Like this person's canceled. I don't believe in that. I believe in having the difficult conversations and sitting down and confronting the difficult questions without being like that, you know, we should burn that book or never read that book in high school ever again or whatever. For me, it's about uplifting certain voices, uplifting Black and Brown voices, and other minorities as well, Native Americans, Asian Americans, or and international writers as well. But also being able to read that Robert Frost, that Walt Whitman, that brought me so much, you know? So it would be interesting to see moving forward, especially during the pandemic, how syllabi are going to change in schools. That'll be interesting to see.
Absolutely. I would like to ask you, because you're 26, if you could talk to yourself in 25 years, like in our 50s, we're in our 40s and 50s, what would you say to yourself? And where do you see yourself at that age?
Ooh, I see myself with a lot of land. I really want to grow my own food. I really want to educate people about returning to the earth and to nature. That's a big part of who I am, and I hope to do that in the future. My dream is to make goat cheese. I don't know why that's my dream, but I see myself like at the farmer's market selling goat cheese.
Okay.
But a kind of simplicity, and I think I would tell myself to never settle. I mean, I would hope that I stay as avant-garde and as changeling as I am now. I know that my mom is also an artist and she's always also changing. So I hope to keep that youthful energy, you know, of just being curious and being open-minded and not, even when I think I know everything, you know, to not settle for that and to just keep exposing myself to more and more and more and just being open. Remaining open is really interesting, I think.
I honestly am getting so many chills throughout this episode. I don't know about you guys, but just you are so wise. You are an old soul. You are so learned and so, you know, we think as we get older that, and we do, we go through a lot of experiences and we learn from them, but we can still, no matter what age we are, we need to talk and have conversations with 3-year-olds and 90-year-olds, you know, and those in between, because we're all human beings and we are all growing and evolving. And your life, you're really experiencing and life and being passionate. So if people do want to contact you and talk with you or see what you're doing, how can they do that?
Absolutely. I have the Instagram at bedrockbody. And I also have my website, which is bedrock-body.com. And I'd be happy for people to just, you know, I'm all about building bridges and having a very, very diverse community. So I'm interested to engage with more people for sure.
Well, thank you for helping to build this bridge with us. Now, my name is Karen. And I told you that my kids said to me, Mom, you need to change your name. Because, you know, there's the Karen thing going on right now. And while I do not identify with that type of woman, that characteristic, if you look it up right now, is a white, middle-class, privileged woman. So I just wanted to know your thoughts on that.
Yeah, I mean, meme culture is its own thing. I think it's not really good to make fun of anyone whatsoever. And at the expense of anyone, you know, to laugh at and point fingers at people. I don't support that in general. I think people can get carried away with that, especially on the internet, you know, because they don't realize that real people are being affected. But I mean, for you, I would just say, like, you know, you have to embody fully who you are. And right. I wouldn't change your name.
I'm not changing my name.
I would not change your name. I would, you know, embrace the name and, and kind of prove to people that that is just a stereotype, and all stereotypes and all prejudices are not good. Like, that's not what we're moving forward with,
right,
on either side of the aisle. So,
well,
you know,
I appreciate that.
Speaking, if you do want to speak about the white woman in the suburbs, I will say that the white woman in the suburbs has a lot of power, a lot of influence over her family. And you know, especially with the election coming up, I mean, either way, everyone has a civic duty. You also have to go beyond that, you know, the voting and that civic duty. But the white woman as a demographic has a lot of responsibility, has always had a lot of responsibility, and we need to pay more respect to those women who, you know, whether they've chosen to pursue their careers or not, I mean, it's a whole job to raise a family. And again, that's the future that we're looking towards. Those are the children that are going to run the world. So, you know, embrace your name.
I'll embrace my name. And I'm going to start a new trend of caring Karens. Caring, compassionate Karens.
I love that. I love that.
This was wonderful. And the ladies, Ella, know how I've been feeling about what's happening in our world and where to dive in and help or what to do first and all these things. And I expected to be, I expected to say a lot more, but I was just really so content to listen to you and your wisdom and how gentle and appropriate everything was. I just like lost all of my needs and wants. I this was very fulfilling. It was great. I really, I mean, I have work to do. No, there's no question about that, that didn't change. And that will change going forward, but you're very lovely to listen to and have so much great wisdom. So I appreciate you. Thank you.
Well, thank you so much.
Yeah, I would just add to that, that it doesn't matter if you're, you know, you're 26 or 96. I mean, I think we all, when we really sort of look inside, you know, you see what your passions are, what your skills are, your talents, your background. And there are so many different ways to tap into that, to, you know, use all that for good, right? For good in the world, to put things out there, to have these conversations, to add value in places that you can. And I think one of the silver linings of this quarantine is that I think we're all learning a lot about ourselves as well. Not that we're only looking, you know, inside. I mean, we're certainly doing a lot of looking at the world and that we live in, but it is giving us this opportunity to maybe even discover new things, new talents, new skills, new, you know, I've never made bone broth, but you know,
right.
Right. I'll watch your friend do it. And I think a silver lining is that now we have a little bit more opportunity to do that. So it doesn't matter how old you are, Elle, I think you're doing a phenomenal job of sort of like literally tapping into all of what you have and what you can give and what you can offer and sort of finding so many different ways to do that. So I think we could all put that in the lesson book of what we should all be doing no matter how old we are.
Well, thank you so much.
Thank you, Ella, so much for giving us life lessons from a millennial. Thank you for joining us on Grateful Goddesses.
Thank you so much.
Up next, favorite things, opening up to happiness and joy.
Welcome everyone to Favorite Things with our guest, Ella St. Hilaire. So we're going to talk about favorite things. It could be rituals, objects, photos, colors, the blue sky, anything that brings you joy and happiness. Because as we know, when we focus on positivity, we bring more positivity into our life. So Dina, would you like to start today?
Sure. So I have to say, when we sat down this morning, I literally forgot my favorite thing to bring it. Like, I don't even know how this even happened.
Okay.
And then I had like some lip balm with me and I was going to use that. And I'm sitting here thinking about it. And I'm like, no. And I don't have the actual object to show, but I will tell you one thing that my youngest daughter and her best friend are doing. They are decorating rocks during quarantine, the way that these two best friends can get together on each other's back decks. And they've been putting them around our neighborhood, and they put one in front of our home and they're gone. Like, kids or people are taking them for their messages or their, you know, decorative nature. And it's been really fun and inspiring. And a friend of mine has a home in Indiana and she brought back really big rocks because we really wanted to start doing messages and putting those around. That's to go next week. But it makes me so happy that they're being enjoyed by the neighbors or neighbors' kids that are on these like scavenger hunts for them.
What kind of messages are written on it? On them?
So they've done like different things, love and peace, and we're all in this together. And they've done, you know, Leslie Jordan's my, like, it's my favorite Instagram in the moment.
Right, right. The what y'all girls. Doing, right.
Yeah, she made like his butt, like a butt, like they do, you know, everything. A ladybug, Donald Duck, I mean.
Oh,
yeah,
that's such a great activity. I love that.
Really, and it's really, you know.
That's great. Rachel, what's your favorite today?
So in this episode, we've been talking about our, you know, your passion and being artistic. And I'm at the Jersey Shore staying with my in-laws and my mother-in-law. She knits beautiful blankets. She makes beautiful jewelry. and she does all of this. So you can see all this. I don't know if you can see this.
Yes.
On this side, this is the primary side.
It's rhinestones.
So beautiful. Every year she gets a gift for my birthday. And one year I said, all I want is one of your pieces of jewelry. So anyway,
does she sell them?
Sometimes.
Okay, so we need to add a link. We need to add a link on the website for her if people want to take a look at her pieces. Now, you know, you got to start a business now that she's in, you know, we're in quarantine and she can sell them.
Yeah. Rachel, I want one of those.
Beautiful, colorful. It certainly puts a smile on my face to look at it. Alyssa, how about you?
Okay, so mine is not nearly as artistic as Dina and Rachel's today, but it is something that's getting me through quarantine. I discovered a local company. I love supporting local businesses, especially now, but this company also does business throughout the US, and it's called eatcooked.us. And what they do is they provide sort of prepared, healthy meals. And my family now, there's four of us living under one roof, operating on four totally different schedules. And I decided I no longer wanted to be a short order cook. So these meals come packaged, prepared, and you know, you order them by the week. They are really not expensive. You just basically peel off the top and it's ready to go. So it couldn't be any easier. And I do feel like the ingredients are very simple, very, very fresh. And on those days and times when I just can't cook anymore, it's really been a lifesaver. So
no,
it's
I hear you. So I am quarantining here in Canada. I came to visit my son and my parents. And while I'm here, if you can see behind me, there's beautiful artwork, right? My mom painted that. My dad painted that. So I'm excited, and this is going to be one of my favorite things. I'm actually really, I don't consider myself an artist, but I am excited to be with my parents and my children all together. I'm just missing my husband, but we are going to paint today. And these are canvases, and I'm so excited for the favorite ritual of being with my parents. What my creations are going to be, because really the favorite thing for me is not so much the product, as much as I love the product of what they made. I can't wait to paint with them in that journey. That's my favorite thing today. Ella, how about you?
So I brought a little totem or object. It's a ceramic from Morocco that I got last time I was there. And Morocco is a really important place to me. I lived there for 4 months, and then I went back twice in 2018, and I have a lot of connections there, and I put this on my altar, and every morning I have a meditation practice, and this kind of, you know, it's a beautiful blue eye, and it reminds me to just tap into my intuition, to listen to myself, to ground down, so it's kind of a favorite thing and a ritual at the same time. But it holds a lot of really special energy for me. And that's my daily reminder to just really listen.
And when you meditate, do you focus on the third eye, like raise your
in
eyes?
In some meditations, yeah. Kundalini yoga is very
we learned
specific.
About that. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, but definitely some meditations, especially when you're imagining your vision or what you want to come to fruition, you definitely project through the third eye. It's very powerful.
Well, we're going to have you on again to talk about that and also a hair episode too, right?
Yes.
Like we said, but thank you so much for joining us on Grateful Goddesses. You are
thank
definitely
you.
The ultimate millennial goddess.
Oh, thank you so
thank
much
you.
For having me.
Thank you, Ella.
Unleashed your inner goddess yet? Thanks for joining us today on Grateful Goddesses. We invite you to visit our website, www.gratefulgoddesses.com, to access today's show notes as well as other helpful resources. Don't forget to leave a review. Until next time, stay strong and empowered to be a grateful goddess.